Appreciate that, Pastor. So I want to learn us really good this morning. Is that okay? get the hook out, right? Okay. Well, again, my name's Russ Miller. My wife, Joanna, is here as well. And again, we have a ministry we feel God gave us to steward that we call Creation, Evolution, and Science Ministries. And we came up with that name because sometimes we talk about creation and biblical accounts, and sometimes we talk about Darwinism and evolutionary accounts. But we always try to tie these two religious beliefs about our origins, and they're both religious beliefs about our origins, into the actual scientific evidence. You know, for the last 54 years, we've taught our children, anyone under the age of 70 now has been taught when they were in school, that the religious belief of Darwinian evolutionism, how it came about on our own through random chance over millions of years, is science, whereas creation is a religious belief, when actually they're both religious beliefs. Aren't they both beliefs about our origins? Yeah, they're both beliefs about our origins. I'd like to take real science, a believer's best friend, by the way, and use that to show people only the biblical view holds up, which is why the secularists who own the schools, the humanists own the schools, the system, museums, this is why they won't let you see both sides. If you look at both sides, no one would believe the humanist side. So they have to have a total monopoly. And that's not education, that's indoctrination. I like to show both sides. See, the thing that's going on is that you are involved in the greatest world war in the history of the world. And most people don't even know what's going on. You see, this isn't a war on terror. This is far more serious than that. This isn't a war that involves bullets and bombs and nuclear-powered aircraft carriers. This is far more serious than that. See, those type of wars can kill your body. This is the war for your eternal soul. This is a war that's already claimed the eternal soul of not millions, billions of people. It's the war for your soul, the soul of anyone you know, anyone you've ever laid your eyes upon, anyone that will ever live in the future. And today, in essence, this is a war that Satan versus God that started in the Garden of Eden a few thousand years ago. But it's being played out in our society in a war of worldviews. The secular worldview, whose foundation is millions of years of death and suffering, which is a belief, leading to a second belief, Darwinian evolutionism, that you evolved all on your own without God and you are your own God. We call that humanism. Versus a biblical worldview, which is based on a perfect creation that was corrupted by Adam's sin that separates from God, requiring our redemption through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'll explain that a little bit more in depth in just a moment, but this is Karl Marx. He's known as the father of communism. He said, people without a heritage are easily persuaded. People that don't know their nation's history are easily persuaded because they won't see anything to stand up for if they don't know what their nation's heritage is all about. In fact, he said the first battlefield is the rewriting of a nation's history. You see, if you don't understand your especially in the United States, our great Christian heritage has led to the freedoms that we have that the rest of the world envies, you won't see any reason to stand up for your borders or for your nation. You might even let millions of people invade your country and not say a thing about it, because you don't see anything special about your country. This really came home to my wife, Joanna, and I. A couple of years ago, we were back in speaking at some churches back in Maryland and Virginia, and we had a day off, so we went in to the nation's capital, Washington, D.C., and we took a Christian tour of the area, and it blew us away. It blew us away with what we found etched in 2-foot-tall letters in the stone walls of federal institutions all over this nation's capital. What we found inscribed in brass and gold and other precious metals all over federal institutions in this nation's capital. Praises to our glorious biblical creator. Entire Bible verses and letters 2 feet tall etched into the stone walls. And we looked at each other and we said, our kids aren't even told about this. In fact, they're taught just the opposite of this today. Our nation's heritage over the last 40 years has been rewritten. It's been stolen from our children and our grandchildren. Well, the Bible says my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge, so I felt led to put together a message that I call, If the Foundations Be Destroyed. I want to show you over the next few minutes that America was founded by predominantly Christian men and women on predominantly Christian principles. That biblical creation is absolutely essential to America's freedoms. And that to destroy the United States of America or Christianity, All you need do is destroy people's faith in biblical creation. The first few chapters of the book of Genesis. And this is why, for the last 60 or so years, you've seen biblical creation right in Satan's crosshairs. He doesn't have to get you not to know what the Bible says if he can just get you to believe it's not true. In fact, Founding Father Jedediah Moore stated, whenever the pillars of Christianity shall be overthrown, our present Republican forms of government must fall with them. Not might fall with them, must fall with them. And to destroy the pillars of Christianity, all you need do is destroy people's faith in the early chapters of the book of Genesis. See, this is where we are laid down the foundation for the gospel message, for the entire biblical worldview. I call this the cost. This is where we're told God gave us a perfect creation. Try to imagine that. It's beyond human comprehension. It was perfect. There was no death. There was no evil. There was no suffering. It was perfect. What in the world happened to it? You know, a good scoffer will come up to Christian kids the first week of college, and colleges are full of hundreds of paid professionals, and they'll say, hey, any Christians in here? Some kid raises their hand. Boy, they're going to get singled out. Oh, you're a Christian. Hey, I might like to be a Christian, but I've got a question I just can't get over. You Christians have this loving God that knows and cares about all of us, right? Yeah, that's our loving God. And he even knows the numbers of hairs on our head, right? Which is, of course, easier for some people, you know, than others. But yeah, that's our loving God. Well, here's my problem. My aunt's dying of cancer. Three kids were killed in a car accident in that intersection last night. We have wars, death, and disease reigning over the planet. Where is your loving God? Grow up. And if that child doesn't know the biblical answer, and today 99 out of 100 adult Christians cannot answer that question, how do we have a loving God in a world full of death, that kid will be one of the 90% that leave the church by the age of 20. He'll probably be gone by the next morning. So if you leave here with nothing else today, know how to respond biblically to the question, how do we have a loving God in this world full of death? Well, here's the biblical answer. It's right here in Genesis 1 and 3. The answer is simply God didn't give us the world the way it is today, full of death and suffering. God gave us a perfect creation. Well, what in the world happened to it? Adam's original sin. You see, Adam's original sin brought on the curse that allowed death to enter. And that's why we live in a world full of death today, but we have a loving God. It's a simple answer, isn't it? Now you guys can share it with other people. But there's more to the message, and that message is this. Adam walked in the garden with God. Why don't we walk in the garden with God today? Well, see, that original sin separated us from our Creator, requiring that we be redeemed with Him. And my friends, despite our separation, which is what we deserve for eternity, that's what we all deserve. We deserve to be separated for eternity. Despite that, our loving God sent His only begotten Son to suffer and die in our place. What a loving God we have. See, when we can't answer this simple question, we lose the foundation for the gospel message. Next time somebody asks you, how do we have a loving God in a world full of death, or doesn't understand why something bad has happened in their life, explain this to them. Our sin brought in death and corruption, separates from God. But God loves us so much that despite our rebellion, which is what sin is, He sent His only begotten Son to suffer and die on a cross. Wow, what a loving God we have. Wow. And now you guys all know how to answer that question if you didn't already have it down. You know, but Moses also told us through the inspiration of God that God has judged man's sin once already with a flood of waters that covered all the high hills under the whole heaven. My friends, this is the whole linchpin in the war of worldviews. I explained this in more detail yesterday, but just briefly, if there had really been a global flood, and what do I mean this is a linchpin? You know, most Christians don't give the global flood a second thought. This is the entire linchpin in the war of worldviews. Let me show you why. You see, if there had really been a global flood, like the Bible says, and you're going to get tired of hearing me say this, but the outer crust of the earth would be made up of sedimentary layers stratified out by moving water. So it would be stratified out by grain size, weight, and density. So you had all shale layers, all sandstone layers, all mudstone layers stratified out, just like a miner in his pan sloshes the sediments back and forth, and the moving water stratifies out the sediments in his pan by grain size, weight, and density. And what do we find today? The outer crust of the earth averages a mile deep of stratified layers, stratified out by moving water by grain size, weight, and density. So you have all shale layers, all sandstone layers, all mudstone layers. And those layers are full of billions of things that were drowned and buried so quickly they didn't even have time to rot away or get eaten by scavengers. We call those fossils today. It's exactly what would be there if the Word of God were true. And the Word of God is true. People walk around saying, oh, I've never seen any proof of a global flood. They've been walking on it their whole life. Why do I say the global flood's the linchpin? Well, see, the humanistic religious worldview, which has been taught in our schools as science now for 54 years, is based on the exact same sedimentary layer stratified out by grain size, weight, and density. They just deny the global flood as foretold in 2 Peter 3, 3 through 6. They would do in the last days. We cover that in our global flood teaching like we did yesterday. But this was all foretold 2,000 years ago in the last days. Scoffers would do this. But they say, hey, there was never a global flood. Those layers laid down by water formed slowly over millions and billions of years of time as man slowly evolved without God. Well, that puts death before Adam. Before man. Do you see that? That's what the whole battle is about. These old earth beliefs didn't just come about by accident. They were deliberately designed to put death before Adam in people's minds. They were only invented 215 years ago. They didn't even start to become popular until 160 years ago. And the first fruit, remember we tell good from bad from the fruit? The first fruit was Darwinism. Came out of just a handful of years after the old earth beliefs were invented. But what they're teaching is that, hey, kids, there was no creator. Come on, man, there was no perfect creation corrupted by some sin that brought death into the world. No, it was death that brought you into the world. Isn't that what they teach? They teach it was billions of years of death that brought you into the world. The biblical message is our sin brought death into the world, corrupting a perfect creation, separated us from God, requiring our redemption. You put death before Adam, you just undermine the foundation of the gospel message. Well, atheists have understood this since they invented the old earth beliefs, but this from American atheists, destroy original sin by putting death before Adam, and in the rubble you'll find the sorry remains of the Son of God. If Jesus was not the Redeemer who died for our sins, and this is what evolution means, and every old earth belief that puts death before Adam, no matter how well-intentioned you might have thought they were, Christianity is nothing. I agree with that statement 100%. He's absolutely right. And that's why we need to learn how to stand on the real science and the truth of God's Word. Compromising with old earth beliefs, all you do is you put death before Adam. I used to be a theistic evolutionist. That's a Christian who thinks God used evolution and millions of years of death to get us here. But today, studies say half of Christians are either theistic evolutionists, progressive creationists, gap theorists, some way trying to fit these old earth beliefs that put death before Adam into God's Word. They don't mix. All you do is undermine the gospel when you do that. So what I try to do is show people why there's no scientific reason to believe the atheist interpretation, misinterpretation of the world, and how the biblical interpretation fits fine. I get a lot of weird emails. Here's one. Your attempt to convince others Darwinism isn't true is unconstitutional. You're a danger to society and should be in a mental institution before you take away the freedoms given to us by our forefathers. Now, as crazy as that sounds, that's almost verbatim what's taught in public school today. Those Christians are trying to impose some theocracy on America and take away our freedoms. My friends, your freedoms come from the fact that we were a Christian-based nation. So let's look at the fingerprint of God upon the history of the United States, that history that has been stolen today. Well, believe it or not, by the early 1700s, the pilgrim zeal for God had pretty much dissipated in the land that was soon to become the United States. Here's an important thing to understand, though. Though the people and the church had stopped preaching Christ died for your sins, the people and the church still had that creation-based foundation. They still understood a perfect creation had been corrupted by sin that had separated them from God. They still understood the need for a redeeming Savior because they had the proper creation foundation. When the Apostle Paul preached to people who had not accepted Jesus Christ as their Messiah, but they had the proper creation foundation, so they understood the need for redemption, like the Jews, he just preached Christ died for your sins, and they could understand that was the Messiah, and he could reap a bountiful harvest of saved souls. So God sent over some British evangelists who teamed with a handful of still God-honoring pastors, and they began preaching, Christ died for your sins. Most churches slammed the door right in their face. So they went out to open fields and meadows, preaching, Christ died for you. And God poured forth his blessing as the crowds grew to the thousands, and churches returned to preaching, Christ died for your sins, in what is known as the first great Christian awakening in this land. And all 13 colonies soon united as one nation under God and demanded and won back their God-given freedoms from the British through the Revolutionary War. In fact, the Liberty Bell is inscribed with Leviticus 25:10. That reads, proclaim liberty throughout all the land unto all the inhabitants thereof. Etched right into the Liberty Bell. Well, Jesus Christ said that whosoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I'll liken unto a wise man who built his house upon a rock. And the rains ascended and the floods came, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. The rock is the non-compromised word of God. In fact, of our founding fathers, 93% of the signers of the Declaration of Independence were Christians. 95% of the authors of the Constitution were Christians. This nation was never meant to be a Christian theocracy, but it was founded on predominantly Christian principles by Christian men and women. One of those principles is that God made man in his own image, male and female. Now today, our kids are taught to be ashamed of American and embarrassed of Christianity. Our high schoolers graduate, you see the snowflakes out there, right? Realize they're victims. They're victims of these secular teachings. They're teaching our kids to be ashamed to be Americans, embarrassed of Christianity, while the rest of the world risks their lives to get here. Man, there's something wrong there. But one of the things they're taught is our founding fathers were horrible, terrible people and slave owners, etc. And realize this. This nation was found in a land and a world already full of slavery. They didn't found the United States and bring slavery here. It was already all over the land. You couldn't outlaw slavery and get 13 colonies to unite and take on the world's only superpower in a war for their God-given freedoms. But in the very Declaration of Independence, they put in the Christian-based belief that all men are created equal and endowed by their who? Creator with certain unalienable rights. As an American citizen, your freedoms come from your biblical creator. And we've been teaching the last 54 years of our citizens there's no creator. Well, you can see where that's going today, can't you? We came about that close to losing our freedoms a few months ago. And you can see the war is raging today. But your freedoms come from your biblical creator. I'm going to get back to that in a moment. But it took about 80 more years and the death of hundreds of thousands of Americans to get rid of the yoke of slavery. And that's a history we should be proud of. Hundreds of thousands of Americans sacrificed their lives to get rid of slavery. See, now that's a message that pulls everybody together. But see, that's not the goal. Here's another email. You won't get away with your Christian lies. The Constitution is a secular document. Well, let's look at what the facts may say. According to the authors themselves of the U.S. Constitution, they listed the King James Bible as the number one reference source of the Constitution. See, the correct way to interpret the Constitution is through the view that all men are created equal, endowed by their Creator with certain freedoms. That's the view you're supposed to look at the Constitution from. In fact, John Adams, our second president and founding father, said our Constitution was made for a moral and a religious people. It's wholly inadequate to the government of any other. See, to handle the freedoms that our founding fathers gave to us through our biblical creator, you have to have extremely high moral and ethical standards or you won't be able to handle those freedoms, which explains a lot of issues we have in this nation today. In fact, Thomas Jefferson, our third president and principal author of the Declaration of Independence, as president, he attended Christian church services that were held in the U.S. Capitol building and in the Supreme Court building. He wrote the education plan for the D.C. schools using the King James Bible as the primary reading book. Well, wait a minute. Didn't our founding fathers understand that separation of church and state they put in the First Amendment? Well, actually, nowhere in the U.S. Constitution is there anything about separation of church and state. that information was gleaned and misinterpreted from a letter Thomas Jefferson wrote to some Baptists in Connecticut to explain to them basically that the First Amendment had erected a wall, and the purpose was to keep the church in the government so it wouldn't become corrupted. Might give you an idea of what's wrong today too, while keeping the government out of the church so it wouldn't corrupt the church like it had in England. In fact, in my my book, The Cost, there are three items in the addendum. One of those three is Thomas Jefferson's letter to the Baptists. You can see it in there. Now, sad to say, by the late 1700s, Europe's Age of Reason had invaded the United States. This was a group of man-made philosophies that tried to answer all of life's questions and get God out of the picture. And sad to say, most of the American people and much of the Christian church again stopped preaching Christ died for your sins. But they still held that creation-based foundation. They still understood a perfect creation had been corrupted by sin that had separated them from God. They still understood the need for a redeeming Savior. Well, Pastor Lyman Beecher became a pastor, and in the 1820s, he began going out in open fields and town squares preaching, Christ died for your sins. And again, God poured forth his blessing in what is known as the second great Christian awakening in this land. And churches and people returned to preaching, Christ died for your sins. The cornerstone of the Washington Monument was laid down in 1848. Inside of the cornerstone were placed the Declaration, the Constitution, and the King James Bible. Christian engravings are found throughout that stone structure, which I'll get back to this but in a few minutes, but the cornerstone was laid down in 1848. The Capitol building was dedicated in 1858. Christian engravings are found in letters up to 2 feet tall throughout the stone walls, like America, God shed his grace on thee, and in God we trust. Well, the Second Great Awakening led the final crusade to abolish slavery once and for all in this nation. And in fact, the Battle Hymn of the Republic included the words as, Christ died to make men holy. Let us die to make men free. Amen. And hundreds of thousands of Americans left their families, their children, their farms, their jobs behind and went and died a horrible, terrible death on a lonely battlefield to free slaves they had never seen, would never know. Now, that's a great Christian heritage this nation should enjoy, and it would pull all people together. Right. We should be together. What a great country we have. The strength of this nation is all the different people groups we have. And I explained why we have different people groups all made in the image of God yesterday. So I won't do that again today, but it's in our books and stuff as well. It's a great lesson. But the cornerstone of the Washington Monument was laid down in 1848. It wasn't completed and dedicated until 1884. The delay was due to the Civil War. And a great piece of our heritage is if you go to Washington, D.C., and I would really suggest you do before these things all get erased, and they are being erased, but if you stand at the base of the Washington Monument and look up at it, it towers 545 feet above the ground. About a third of the way up, about 160 feet up, the stone changes color. You see, after the war, they used a different colored rock to finish the memorial. And that change in color marks a clear line of demarcation when our nation, based on our Christian-based beliefs that all men are created equal, and after hundreds of thousands of Americans gave their lives, finally lived up to those beliefs, and we got rid of the yoke of slavery. So they finished the memorial, they dedicated in 1884, and at the dedication ceremony, they put an aluminum cap, it's about 18 inches tall, on the very top of the memorial. The east-facing side of the aluminum cap is the first sayings lit by the rays of the sun every morning in Washington, D.C. Have been since 1884. And in the east-facing side of that cap, they etched in the Latin words, Laus Deo. The first words lit by the rays of the sun every morning in Washington, D.C. translate, praise be to God. I don't think they teach that in our schools today. The Supreme Court building was dedicated in 1935. And the eastern entryway, above the entryway, are statues of history's greatest lawmakers, all seated around Moses, who's holding the Ten Commandments. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. In fact, in 1950, Harry Truman told the nation, The fundamental basis of the nation's law was given to Moses on the Mount, the Ten Commandments. He said, if we don't have the proper fundamental moral background, we'll end up with a totalitarian government. We miss that by this much, and the war is raging today, is it not? In fact, in 1952, Dwight Eisenhower stated the real fire of the builders of America was faith in themselves as children of God. Oh, the Bible says you're children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. At his inaugural ceremony in 1961, John Kennedy told the nation, the rights of men come not from the generosity of the state. Your rights come from the hand of God. You're endowed by your biblical creator with certain inalienable rights that no one can take away from you because they weren't given to you by a government. They're given to you by God. And we've been teaching the last 54 years of our citizens, there's no creator. Wow, what a dangerous place to be. Yeah. But blessed is a nation whose God is the Lord. And we were a blessed nation before we actually became the United States and for the first 200 years of our existence as a nation, we were a blessed nation. We were never a perfect nation. We were never perfect for a billionth of a second. We're made up of millions of sinful people, only saved by the grace of God. But we are a blessed nation because as a whole, we are a God-honoring nation. In fact, one of the greatest Americans of all time, definitely our greatest educator, was Noah Webster. He said, he wrote the first American dictionary and the blueback speller, which was used to train up America's children, when under this man's tutelage, we rose to being the greatest nation on earth. He said, the Christian religion is one of the first things in which all children ought to be instructed. Is that what we've been doing for the last 54 years? We've been doing just the opposite, haven't we? What in the world happened? Well, the successful attack on people's faith in the Word of God actually started about 215 years ago when some people started reinterpreting those sedimentary layers laid down by water that make up the crust of the earth, saying, hey, wait a minute, those layers didn't form in a global flood. There was never a global flood, just like foretold would happen in 2 Peter 3, 3 through 6. No, those layers formed slowly over millions of years, putting death before man. And then in 1859, about 55 years later, Darwin's book came out. Today, kids are told the name of the book is Origin of Species by means of natural selection, but actually, that was only half of the title. Second half of the title was over the preservation of favored races in the struggle for life. Yeah, they don't tell that to kids on college campuses today, do they? You see, if you think you're the favored race, well, you can do what you want to the less evolved animals. It's what the Nazis thought in World War II. It's what the Japanese thought. It's what the Mao Zedong thought in China. Yeah. On and on you can go. In fact, in our evil fruit of old earth beliefs, which we'll show tonight at 6, is it 6? 6 o'clock. I will show you how one of the evil fruits of millions of years is Darwinism, and the two have combined to lead to the premature death of not millions, billions of people over the last 150 years alone. Billions. I'll show you that tonight. But remember, this book came out when we still had slavery in the United States. Something we should keep in mind. Well, it wasn't until 1947, 167 or so years after the Constitution was ratified, that suddenly the Supreme Court discovered a separation of church and state in the First Amendment. Well, believe it or not, this was while ruling in favor of using federal funds to support religious school activities. What in the world happened? We see our laws are no longer based on the never-changing Ten Commandments. No, they're now based on what's called case law study. Case law means the law evolves case by case. That's the reason there's no foundation for our laws anymore. We kicked out the Ten Commandments. That's the reason you see one guy do a crime, he gets 2 years in jail. Another guy does the same crime, gets 20 years in jail. Another guy does the same crime, gets off scot-free because the law evolves now, case by case, case law study. So 15 years later, in 1962, the law had evolved. And the Supreme Court used the same finding to outlaw prayer in school. And this is the year to keep in mind, 1963. 1963 is the year when the United States of America officially, which had been blessed so much by God, kicked him out of our schools and public squares. It was 1963. We kicked creation and prayer out of our public schools and replaced them with the religious foundation of secular atheism, billions of years leading to Darwinian evolution. 54 years ago. You ever heard that if you don't believe the secular atheist foundations, millions of years of Darwinism, you're anti-science? Hear something along those lines? That's a bluff and propaganda. Don't let them get away with that. Did you know that there's about 200 branches of modern science? Did you know that about 164, over 80% of the branches of science are started by Christians to study God's creation? Did you know that? There would be no science without Christianity. How do you set out to study random chance? You can't. You see, we thought, hey, we've got an intelligent creator. He probably put some laws and principles in place to govern the creation. We call it nature today. And if we study the creation, we can discover those things and put them to use in our own lives. That's the reason we have science today. It's been undermined by secular atheists over the last 150 years, and now they own the entire system and block looking at both views, because if you looked at both views, no one would accept their belief system. So they only teach their view, and they fool people by the billions into accepting it as if it were science, when it's really their belief on how we came about. So it was 1963. In fact, let me make a point here. From the 1600s, look at this as a big timeline. From the 1600s through the 1700s, through the 1800s, all the way through 1962, we had daily prayer to God with our children, and we taught our children biblical creation. Now, in 1962, our nation was number one in the world in education, number one in the world in math, number one in the world in science, number one in the world in engineering, number one in the world in military power, number one in the world in economy, number one in the world in standard of living, number one in the, well, you get the picture. We are a nation blessed by God. Amen. Then in 1963, a year later, we kicked creation and prayer out of our schools, and for just 54 years now, we've been teaching our kids they evolved without God. How are we looking today? We're how many trillions in debt? Beyond human comprehension in debt? Our schools rank in the bottom 20% in the world. We have to bring in, even though we've driven off 80% of our manufacturing, we have to bring in engineers from foreign countries because we're not producing them ourselves anymore. How's that working out? Hey, listen, and if you want to know, if you want to really see how awesome and true God's Word is, when you get home today, just take 2 minutes. That's all it'll take, 2 minutes, and read Romans 1, verses 15 to 30, and see what God says He will allow to happen to a nation He has blessed if they turn their back on Him. And you will be blown away. You will read Romans 1, 15 to 30, and you'll go, praise God. He's in total and complete control. If you wonder, where is God in all this? I'll tell you where He is. He is right there, giving us exactly what He said He would do. You see, God keeps all of His promises. We'll talk about that tonight. He keeps all of His promises, and that's what we can put our faith in. 1963. Now, there are some good and godly teachers in our public schools. Don't get me wrong. There's probably some in here today. But you've got to realize, they're forced to teach the federal curriculum, and it's the curriculum that's corrupted. And I cover this in our public education menticide. I've only shown it live 8 times. 24 kids have been pulled out of public school that I know of. And one teacher resigned her job, saying, I'll never teach this again. It's a powerful teaching. Public education menticide. It's powerful enough nobody wants to see it. That's the reason I'm only showing it 8 times. You see, the kids today are taught it's a fact that life on Earth has evolved. Now, I'm an evolutionist, a microevolutionist. All Christians are evolutionists, microevolution. There's Darwinian evolution is macro. Now, the other side won't spell out the difference between the two, because if they did, everyone would see there's no evidence of Darwinian macro to show anybody. But microevolution is found all the time, and it's biblical. 10 times in Genesis, we're told plants or animals will bring forth after their kind. Dogs bring forth dogs. People bring forth people. We can have adaptations within the kind caused by the loss of genetic information. Anyways, I cover that, and I covered it yesterday, but I cover it in our Science and Darwinism. I won't get into it now, but the Bible says, professing themselves to be wise, they become fools. That doesn't mean they're stupid. Don't get me wrong. I know some brilliant people that have been fooled into believing in Darwinian evolutionism. It's because they haven't seen both sides of it, though. Almost anyone that'll see what I can show them, they'll drop Darwinism like a hot potato. There's no evidence that ever happened. It goes against real science. But they become fools, and they change the glory of the incorruptible God, which I think today is his creation, into an image made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Well, I think they're going to change creation into the fairy tale of Darwinian evolutionism that lets you think you're the most evolved, you're your own God. We call that humanism today. They think they're the most evolved. They're their own God. And that's a dangerous place to be, my friends, because they think then they can do anything they want to the less evolved animals. I'll talk about that tonight. But these verses are talking about idolatry. And again, the highest form of idolatry today is to think you're the most evolved. You're your own God. And I cover Darwinism and our science and Darwinism. Have you ever heard you're 98% the same, your biochemistry as a chimpanzee? You guys hear that all the time, don't they? As I showed yesterday, real science, a believer's best friend, has as much as a 30% difference. Why are they still saying it's less than 2%? Why don't they take the frauds out of textbooks and put in the real evidence of Darwinian evolution? Oh, did I mention they don't have any? Yeah. Anyways, I show people how to scientifically destroy Darwinism in 4 seconds flat. But that's the reason they don't have any evidence. Notice how their proofs are almost always drawings? See that? Drawings. Yeah, there's an old saying that goes like this. Darwinists are experts at drawing things that never existed to support their theory that never took place. Yeah, take away their box of crayons, and they got a big problem on their hands. In fact, a similar biochemistry proves our evolutionary past. They should teach we evolved from worms. Your biochemistry is 75% the same as that from some worms. Yeah, your biochemistry is 50% the same as that from a banana. Anyone evolved from a banana? Just a handful. That's not bad. Yeah, real science is on your side, and Darwinism doesn't take long to destroy if given the opportunity. So how did this fairy tale, it's got no evidence ever happened, it goes against multiple scientific laws and principles, get such a stranglehold over our educational and scientific establishment? So it says right here, it depended on an immense length of time. Millions and billions of years is the foundation. And those beliefs are all based on a belief or strata formed slowly over millions of years, as foretold in 2 Peter 3, what happened? That's why a global flood, if you talk about a global flood, they're going to come at you with everything they got. I can destroy Darwinism on a college campus, they get mad. Nothing they can do about it, but they just get mad. But if I start talking about the age of the earth, I've got to have bodyguards. They understand where the foundations are. But the old earth beliefs put death before Adam. So when we get to arguing, if people get you off track arguing over thousands of years, millions of years, billions of years, although it's an important issue, they've actually got you off track. Stick to the death before Adam. That's the issue. Because Christians don't understand it. They understand, who cares if God used millions of years or thousands of years as long as God did it? They don't realize they're accepting death before Adam beliefs that undermine people's faith in the gospel message. No wonder the Bible says, teach no other doctrine, neither give heed to fables and endless genealogies. Do you know the Bible says don't give heed to endless genealogies that put death before Adam? Wow. I cover this radiometric dating, carbon dating, which is a Christian's best friend, by the way. Pangaea, continental drift, the ice ages, coal layer formation, Grand Canyon's formation. I lead tours to Grand Canyon, take about 1,000 people a year on tours to the canyon. How many of you have been to Grand Canyon? What did you think when you first realized where the original creation rock was? Wasn't that an awesome moment? Oh, nobody showed that to you. What did you think when you first realized where the first of the flood layers lay right on top of the creation rock, where creation and judgment actually physically met? Wasn't that powerful? Oh, nobody showed that to you. When I show it to people, it's like, wow, when did I notice that? I'll give you a hint. The creation rock down the bottom isn't stratified. The stratified layers are the flood layers. And it's real obvious when I point it out. But more than that, from here on the edge of the rim, it was a mile from the rim down to the river. That's a lot of 10 layers laid down by water, a mile from the rim to river. What they won't tell you there, that's nothing. There used to be a mile and a half of layers above today's rim that had been removed from southern Utah all the way to the sea, leaving behind what's called the Grand Staircase, which is Bryce, Zion, Vermilion Cliffs. That's the end of the erosional event. See, there's no way to explain that but a global flood. So if you go to Bryce, Zion, and Grand Canyon, what will they tell you about the event that left them behind? Not a word, nothing. Because there's no way to explain it but a global flood, and a global flood would wipe out every old earth belief that puts death before Adam, including naturalism, Darwinism, and secular atheism. Wow. So they can't talk about it. In fact, there I am on the rim. See that butte right behind my head? That's Cedar Butte. It's a 900-foot remnant above the rim, 900 feet above the rim of layers that have been removed all the way to the sea. And that 900-foot remnant is nothing. There used to be 7,000 feet of layers on top of it. Wow, unbelievable proof of a global flood, and they can't talk about it. And dinosaurs, which we covered this morning, another one of the old earth pillars. Here's another email I got. You're an anti-American communist using religion to take away our freedoms. You are despicable. I said to my wife, who sent me this, Daffy Duck? You're despicable. And the younger people have no idea what I'm talking about. That's... You know, if you go to D.C., and I really do suggest you do, and take a Christian tour, don't just go there and walk around. It's like going to Grand Canyon. You just walk around there. It's just a big hole in the ground. Take a Christian tour when you go to these places. Go to the Jefferson. It's one of my favorites. God has just proclaimed throughout the memorial several of his quotes etched in the stone walls talking about God. One is, God who gave us life gave us liberty. Who gave us our liberties? God, you're endowed by your biblical creator. If you're standing up for Jesus Christ and Christianity, you're trying to preserve and protect our freedoms. Yeah. The people who are anti-God are the ones trying to take your freedoms from you. Darwinian evolution provided the philosophical foundation for communism. In fact, Mao Zedong, who murdered 60 million of his own people just 50 years ago, listed Charles Darwin as his favorite author. Tooth and Claw, Survival of the Fittest, Get Rid of the Less Evolved Animals. That's what Hitler thought. That's what Mao Zedong thought. That's what all communist dictators think. They're the most evolved. They can do what they want to the less evolved animals. The founder of the ACLU said communism is their goal. Did you know that their first office was shared in New York City with the Masses newspaper? That's the largest communist newspaper in America. Their lawsuits include banning the Ten Commandments and Christmas displays. Have their lawsuits strengthened America or weakened America? Now, we dedicated the Vietnam Veterans Memorial in 1982. It does not contain a single reference to God. In World War II, our government issued more than 17 million Bibles to military personnel around the globe. Our government. We dedicated the memorial in 2004. It does not contain a single reference to God. So our nation has changed, my friends. There was a plaque at the base of the Washington Monument talking about the aluminum cap and the words Laos Deo at the top of the cap. 2 years ago, the information about Laos Deo was removed from the plaque. Nobody knows what's up there now. The newest memorial in Washington, D.C. is the memorial to Martin Luther King Jr., who gave his I Have a Dream speech on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial. Now, on the Lincoln, there's three items in the addendum of my book, The Cost. The first is the letter to Jefferson wrote to the Baptists about separation of church and state. The second thing is the second inaugural address of Abraham Lincoln, because our rewriting history is, oh, the war wasn't about getting rid of slavery. Actually, the war to get rid of slavery was about the war to get rid of slavery. In fact, his second inaugural address, etched in the stone walls of his memorial, and it's in my addendum, it's only about 700 words long. It has seven complete Bible verses and 12 references of the need to sacrifice to get rid of the yoke of slavery. I mean, that's what the war was about. The third thing in my addendum is the I Have a Dream speech from Martin Luther King Jr., delivered from the steps of the Lincoln Memorial. The last words of that speech were, free at last, thank God Almighty, we are free at last. And that just wasn't for slaves, that was for our nation as a whole. We were free at last. Well, the newest memorial in D.C. is the MLK Memorial. And they've got the big plaque with his words, free at last, and that's where it ends. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last, is removed from this Baptist pastor's memorial. See, our nation has turned their back on God. Read Romans 1, 15 through 30, and keep 1963 in mind. Ronald Reagan said, "Without God, democracy will not and cannot long endure. If we forget we are one nation under God, we will be a nation gone under." Jesus said, "Everyone that hears these sayings of mine and does them not will be likened unto a foolish man who built his house upon the sand. And the rains descended and the floods came and it fell, and great was the fall of the house built on the ever-shifting sands of man's ever-changing thoughts, ideas, and philosophies." The fact of the matter is the nation and much of the Christian church no longer hold to a biblical worldview. Did you know that over 90% of accredited Christian colleges and seminaries now teach some form of old earth beliefs that put death before Adam? Over 90%. The church has been filled with these people, and only 2% of churches, 2 out of 100, will allow me to share this type of information. 2 out of 100. While we lose 90% of our kids, we are now a secular-based society. Many church leaders tell me, "We don't talk about creation. It's a non-essential." Really? The perfect creation corrupted by sin that separates from God, requiring our redemption, is a non-essential? Wow. But if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? The fact of the matter is, America needs another Christian revival. But before that can happen, the Christian church needs another great awakening. Here's some good news. Despite 54 years of our nation teaching our kids they evolved without God, think about this. 7 out of every 10 U.S. adults says they want to believe biblical creation is true. They say, "Look, we don't believe in creation because we've been taught it's a scientific fact we evolved without God. But if you Christians can tell us how, give us reason for the hope that's in our heart, we would love to believe the Bible's true." But see, the Christian church is too busy compromising on this issue instead of standing up on the truth. So we need, this has to be a grassroots effort. Yeah. And this information, if God wants, he could use it yet for a third great awakening. Hey, listen, don't give up. It's easy to give up today, isn't it? There's so much out there, it seems overwhelming. Don't give up. The Bible doesn't say give up. Where does the Bible say quit, right? Jesus Christ never quit on us, did he? God never quit on us, and we're not supposed to quit on him. We actually have marching orders. We're told to pray continually, spread the word, and contend for the faith once given to the saints. My friends, pray, spread the word, and contend for the faith. That's the calling of our ministry, to teach about creation, evolution, and age of earth issues, and to provide a reason for the hope that's in the heart of every true believer and all true seekers. We do this for our various rim and raft trips to Grand Canyon. I take about 1,000 people a year there. You should join us sometime. We do this for our various PowerPoint teachings. We've got 14 of our messages on our DVDs. Tonight, we'll talk about the evil fruit of old earth beliefs, because Jesus said you tell good from bad by the fruit. I'm going to show you some of the fruit today. It will blow you away, but also show you why it's actually great news for Christians. And once again, you can check out our DVDs in the back. I don't copyright them, so feel free if you get them to make copies and give them to other people. Let's make an impact out there. My book, The Cost, covers the top 10 old earth beliefs, top 10 evil fruit, top 10 Darwinian beliefs, top 10 proofs of creation, and much, much more. We have dinosaur books, coloring books for kids, endowed by their creator about our Christian heritage for kids, with great information in both, so parents will learn it. Just parents, I actually made it so parents would read it and learn the information. It's kind of a sneak attack, you know. So parents, get it, read it, but just don't let your kids catch you coloring it. Unless you're with them, then it's okay. If you're off by yourself coloring it, you know, it's kind of. But let me end with this. I realize, now this was given to the ancient Israelites, but I think it's the best chance we have today. From 2 Chronicles 7:14. "If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land." My friends, I think we're on the precipice, and I think this is the best chance we have left. But pray continually, spread the word, and contend for the faith. Prepare the soil by teaching about creation and evolution issues, and then plant the seed in good prepared soil. Let me end my part with a word of prayer.